quy chuẩn. Ông chúng tôi chụp đẹp cả một tổ cái tâm lạc cả để thi sản lạc cả. Sản lạc cả là ngày này ông chụp đẹp từ sản lạc cả một tổ sản lập tập khai cầm nên đẹp chụp niên. Khi lưu vàng mình chóp hay nâng bắt đầm tập sản khai cầm đầm mình đang ngờ rõt vào bên này để mình hạ dân niếm Pi thi xì xì phí Pi rồi cao sập phẩm bầy. Cả làm chi sản lạc cả lúc rây xài cổ bật khí là đi cả vì thân hiệp vật tầm miền áo vật tầm miền phía ký nâng bắt cô để ông chụp đẹp. Có hình chưa nhờ cho rùm được nông cây châm ra ca, xâm ra ca thay này.
Xong cổ lộc bật thiên, xâm ra xâm ra ca thay này. Làm chi có xong co khơi thả, cổ phía kỳ tiếng ơ này rừng đầy này, miên vọt tầm miên. Lực lên tại lộc lưu sổ bán ná, mê thị vị chết ca phía đầy ảnh lộc nguồn chi, vọt tầm miên đòi mù là hạt sọc hiệp. Hay lộc bệnh ống, mê thị vị chết nông mốc đầm nàng ở đàm đồng rộp bạ về này, vọt tầm miên đòi vẹn tìm mối xâm ra ca bật này, đòi mù là hạt tọc luôn. ដល់ឡៃលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសាលសាមនាការនេះដោយលោកស្នាសុំលះបង់សិទ្ធិមានវត្តមានដោយផ្ទាល់ពីបន្ទប់សាមនាការនៅថ្ងៃនេះលិខិតលះបង់សិទ្ធិរបស់លោកនួនជាបានប្រកល់ដល់កលាមជារួចហើយហើយអ្នកជំនាញដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មបញ្ចប់នៅថ្ងៃនេះគឺលោកស្រីផេកលេវ៉ាញ់លោកស្រីមានវត្តមាននោះទៅហើយនៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សាមនាការនេះហើយដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលវេនីដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មបន្
សូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានអរគុណលោកស្រីខសាយកុលបធីជាដំបូងនេះអង្គជំរះសម្រេចលើសំណើសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាយមុនសិនអង្គជំរះបានទទួលលិខិតសម្រាប់អង្គសិទ្ធចូលរួមក្នុងសកម្មភាពនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចុះថ្ងៃទី12ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2026ដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ថាដែលគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបាន មិនអាចចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនឹងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មភាពនេះហើយខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពរួមធំលះបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមនឹងមានវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃទី12ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2026បានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុពីនិតសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាដែលធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការពីនិតព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនៅអវតកចុះថ្ងៃទី12ខែតុលាឆ្នាំ2026បានគាត់ថ្កល់ពីស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់លោកនួនជានៅថ្ងៃនេ ពីបន្ទប់មួយថាត់ក្រោមសាលសមការនេះ ក៏បិបុកលឹកផ្នែកចតទួជួបប្រព័ន្ធចតទួសម្រាប់ជប់ចតនុនជាឲ្យចូលរួមនៅតាមដំណើរការសម្ការសម្ការពីចម្ងាយក្នុងដំណពីនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្ការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះទីជាបន្តទៅនេះអង្គមេប្រដល់វិការជូនទៅក្រុមសមិទ្ធិនមុខតំណាងដើមរឹងរដ្ឋរវេនីដើម្បីមានឱកាសសួរដេញដោលជំពោះអ្នកសាក់សីជំពោះអ្នកជំនាញសូមជឿ
des passages de votre ouvrage ou des passages des transcripts que nous avons reçus ce matin, tout simplement pour prévenir les interprètes que je vais faire ces citations en anglais puisque votre ouvrage n'a pas été traduit. Si vous avez l'impression que vous avez déjà répondu à ces questions, bien évidemment, vous pouvez l'indiquer et je voudrais vous donner une opportunité de préciser, de nuancer certains des propos que vous avez tenus hier, le cas échéant. Je voudrais commencer avec une première question sur un terme que vous avez rapidement évoqué hier, qui est un terme central dans votre ouvrage, qui est le terme de « ritual side ». Vous avez évoqué hier à 11h05, donc je me réfère aux transcripts en anglais puisque ce sont les seuls que nous avons reçus ce matin. Vous avez indiqué, et je vous cite, que vous aviez map the breakdown of traditional rituals over time and the impact that had on an entire population. Pouvez-vous expliquer à la Cour quels étaient les rites traditionnels qui ont été abolis pendant le Kampuchea démocratique de manière nécessairement synthétique vu le temps qui m'est imparti? Et puis je vous poserai une autre question sur l'impact qu'a eu cette disparition des rituels sur la population.
Thank you. Excuse me this morning. With regard to my study into the rituals, as was referenced, I believe, on the first day, I went for painstaking days upon days, went into very old texts, interviewed many people before 1970, so that I could be very clear about not just the rituals, but the sequence by which rituals happened, and what rituals were dropped out, what ritual objects were dropped out, what were added, what dynamics. There's a dynamic in rituals because there's often an exchange between people during the course of a ritual proceeding. So I looked at the rituals of weddings. I looked at the rituals of courtship. That was very important because that's an important sequence for the weddings. And I looked at the sequence of rituals for women from the time they are pregnant through to their delivery and post-delivery time. And in doing that, I was much more able to look at the breakdown of ritual than the breakdown of culture, because culture is so much more an amorphous entity to study. And what I found was that the sequence of rituals for people who were married, men and women, I looked at male and female rituals, even during the birthing time, men had a role, whether it was finding the right fertile ground in which to bury the placenta. So it was very important for me to really pay attention to what were the roles and what were the interacting roles. And what I discovered, because it was a discovery for me, what I discovered was that there was a dramatic change in the ritual structure, in the access people had to rituals formally. Many sought rituals secretly, sometimes at the risk of feeling very afraid. And without rituals for protection, of course, that I was interested in what particular texture or kind of anxiety people experienced by not having a particular kind of protection that is embedded for centuries in Cambodia. I also looked at strategically the difference in rituals in terms of rituals that were happening in urban regions and rituals that were happening in remote regions, so I could get a sense of the ranked order of importance of rituals as well. And so that I was able to very strategically, when people were living in a countryside, when people were living in the countryside and they had been living in an urban region, what they didn't have access to, and similarly when they were being moved from one region to another with unfamiliar topography and geography, and even some nuanced differences in practices, what did that mean for them? That was probably my most profound finding in my study that I didn't set out to look for, and that I found to be most disturbing for my respondents Oftentimes, that was the focus when we spoke about weddings or births, what rituals they did not have access to, or what rituals they had to sneak, or their families had to sneak to find for them.
Je vous remercie. Vous avez fait un parallèle hier que vous faites dans votre ouvrage que vous venez de faire à l'audience maintenant entre la perte de rituels et le manque de protection. Vous évoquez dans votre ouvrage un terme khmer,
pei-kla,
et vous indiquez à quel point la peur a été finalement la conséquence de cette perte de rituel et de ce manque de protection. Pouvez-vous donner un petit peu plus d'explications à la Cour sur ce concept? Est-ce que c'est un concept? Est-ce que c'est un symptôme? Est-ce que c'est quelque chose que vous avez observé uniquement parmi l'échantillon de votre étude ou de manière plus large lorsque vous avez effectué des consultations, puisque nous avons appris au fil de votre déposition que vous avez également reçu en consultation des patients aux États-Unis, mais aussi dans une clinique de Tatmao. Donc, que pouvez-vous nous dire sur ce que vous dénommez Pei-Kla? Un symptôme, un sentiment, une émotion, et quel a été l'impact sur la population en général?
I strategically chose the word dread for the title of my book because I think that word in many ways describes the experiences that people spoke about more than a clinical term, anxiety or post-trauma. Almost in the French en parfait, it extends through time. And this, which I'm speaking to, that the Khmer word may not actually fully be able to realize, this concept of dread was haunting for people. So that everyone that I spoke to saw dead bodies, not that they said that they saw people being killed, but they saw dead bodies, whether it was holding a father who died of starvation or walking along a road and seeing some bodies floating. People saw dead bodies, and when they saw those dead bodies, yes, one would think that that's a traumatic experience, but for them to not have protection and to have the knowledge that the person who died, most likely those who died a violent death, what happens to the spirits of those who died? The unrest is profound. And so, yes, every single person I spoke with in my study, including those that I was interviewing as not part of my formal cohort, so that I could map the rituals, that was the purpose really in those interviews, spoke about a particular kind of dread on a daily basis.
Je vous remercie. Vous évoquez également en page 5 de votre ouvrage la façon dont les liens de parenté ont également été modifiés pendant la période du Kampuchea démocratique. Et vous indiquez ceci, donc je vais lire en anglais une courte phrase. Trust of family, friends and neighbors became conditional rather than unconditional, and many became confused about loyalty and betrayal when separated from the familiar. Pouvez-vous expliquer à la cour de quelle manière ces liens ont été altérés pendant le régime du Cambodge démocratique et quel a été l'impact de cette modification des liens de confiance sur soit votre échantillon, soit la population de manière générale, si vous pouvez généraliser un échantillon plus large de population.
Yes, the issue of trust is very complex. Suspicion, of course, was necessary in order to survive. But, for example, if I can give you a sketch of the complexity of this, because it's not so simple that I don't trust my neighbor, they may daub me in. That's an Australian term. They submit my name for critique. I can think of, as an illustration, two young women walking out of Phnom Penh together, sisters. One is older, one is younger. The other is quite discerning and bright and realizes that it might be important to create a story about our past lives now as we're walking out of Phnom Penh. So for days, the older sister told a story of what their history is and had her sister rehearse that story.
I suppose
they did a good job because they held that story throughout the regime period. But the older sister had this fear, a bit of mistrust, not in her sister, but in her sister's developmental capacity to be able to hold and report that story without being tripped up. So I think that's an illustration of just how difficult this concept of suspicion is in that period, and that people became more and more observational, more and more, at least in those that I spoke with, more and more heightened in their sensory awareness to be ready for anything that might be different, such as the pace of a footstep of someone walking towards someone. If that pace changed, people actually started to know when the pace could mean that they were going to be sent to hard labor by the person coming to them based on the pace. So everything was heightened. I think that's a really important aspect.
Est-ce que cette suspicion que vous décrivez se retrouve dans les histoires des personnes qui font partie de votre échantillon? Pouvez-vous généraliser, considérer que ce climat de suspicion prévalait de manière plus générale pendant le régime du Cambodge démocratique?
I can say that it increased dramatically. But also I want to add that other aspect that was introduced yesterday by the defense, and that is the concept of Ankar, because that creates yet a whole other cosmological dimension of suspicion and dread.
Je vais venir justement à l'encart dans une ou deux questions. Je voulais simplement aborder avec vous les conséquences de la perte de ces rituels sur le mariage, en particulier, et vous avez indiqué dans votre ouvrage, en page 31, et donc je cite encore une fois en anglais, "My findings point to the omission of traditional ritual as a grave violation, and I claim that such omission is a crime against culture." Pouvez-vous expliquer un petit peu plus ce que vous entendez par crime contre la culture? Et pouvez-vous indiquer à la Cour si ce crime contre la culture a eu par ricochet un impact sur les hommes et les femmes qui ont vécu et qui ont été mariés pendant le régime du Kampuchea démocratique.
Because ritual is so much a foundation in the culture, microcultures as well as macrocultures, but I was looking at macroculture mostly here.
The breakdown of that foundational ritual and
the access to that at particular developmental stages in one's life, that's important too.
Yes, I claim that.
Yes, and I'll explain a bit of my answer, because it's important for me to go back to courtship. Because the Khmer Rouge created a particular kind of courtship memento for people that was a microsecond in time. So traditionally, courtship, traditionally, a long time ago, weddings would be arranged, and when the weddings were arranged, there would be a period of time, up to a year, where the couple would be able to spend time together, much more time together, be recognized by the community, and in that regard, the unfolding of recognition of someone, the unfolding of a story that one holds in a relationship moved forward as well, but also an evaluation period for parents on both sides, not usually the couple, parents on both sides, as well as other community members. And I think that's a really important part, that the courtship and the weddings are not just about the nuclear family.
I
was asked a question yesterday about a question I asked in my study about were the weddings real, and this might be a time for me to introduce my answer to that question, which I very much appreciated, because it brought me back into my fieldwork diary. So the question that was posed to me by the prosecution was, how was that term rendered, the term real? At least that was my understanding that was posed to me. So I went back, and the court can make a copy of this. I have the Khmer, and I have the three words that were referenced around real. Real meaning not fake. Real meaning recognized. Real meaning official. So it's this question that gave me the lens that allowed me to capture the within cultural view of the wedding. It also gave me some nuanced understanding of people's interpretations or how they came to interpret the wedding as real. That's all I wanted to do, was to understand that. I considered a statement when I went back into my research last night, and I have one here that I think represents what I'm trying to talk about here as the wedding was just not a nuclear family affair. Yes, the wedding was recognized because the chief of the village and the chief of the commune and parents and brothers and sisters and aunties recognized us as a couple, even though they did not attend the wedding. As official couples, we could now live together. Now, I know that there's a lot in that quote, but the reason that quote was significant to me was, and to digress a moment, first the question was asked, was the wedding real? And the person said, well, yes, it was an official wedding. And my question after that was, please tell me about your answer. But I just want to let you know how I was able to solicit the response I just gave you. So that when we look at rituals and breakdown of rituals, it's really, it was important for me to create a sociogram of the space in which the rituals happened or didn't happen under DK. And that meant that I had to include players. Now what happened was some players were exchanged for other players that were usually in place traditionally. The question for me as a researcher was, did that shift in person in a particular role lead someone to believe something about the wedding they had? Again, a ritual involves more than just one person. It happens in the context.
Je vous remercie. Je vais faire la transition sur par rapport au rôle de l'encart dans les mariages dont vous avez parlé hier. Vous avez indiqué la nature presque mythologique d'encart, en tout cas pour un certain groupe de la population pendant le Kampuchea démocratique. Et vous avez indiqué ceci à 11h06. Vous avez indiqué que certaines personnes attribuaient des pouvoirs transformatif à l'encart, que l'encart était très imprévisible, et je vais vous citer en anglais pour qu'il n'y ait pas de difficultés. So when someone was told that encart was asking them to be married, it was essential that they comply. Dans votre ouvrage, vous parlez très longuement de l'encart. Et vous y associez les termes en anglais, toujours à la page 13. Mistrust, fear, hypervigilance. Est-ce que vous pouvez un petit peu détailler? Aujourd'hui, est-ce que vous avez tiqué? Je suis à la page 13 de votre ouvrage. Mostly, I found that mistrust, fear, and hypervigilance were related to respondents' experiences of encore as a damaging and potentially possessing force. Et vous ajoutez, encore was a power so large that people were afraid to think for fear that encore could read their minds. Vous en avez parlé hier. Pouvez-vous expliquer, si vous souhaitez apporter des précisions, quel a été le rôle de l'encart, la perception de l'encart par les gens que vous avez interrogés, peut-être plus largement par la population, la perception de ces gens au regard du rôle de l'encart dans les mariages.
I heard two questions, the role of Angkar and the role of Angkar in people's weddings. Would you like me to respond to both?
Le rôle de l'Angkar dans les mariages. On va commencer par ça.
When I was doing my interviews, the word Angkar came up so often that I didn't want to just assign the organization to that term. So yes, I explored what is Angkar. I even tried to get images of what Angkar looked like in people's minds because Angkar was presented as some power that was controlling a lot of things that were happening. And yet, as I said yesterday, there was not a headquarters that people could visit, couldn't drive by Angkar's house. They had a very difficult time determining how things were happening. And the more the term Angkar was used, and the more things that were happening was associated with Angkar, the more people began to have that amorphous it. I have to really frame it as an it without gender. This amorphous it then seemed to somehow interact with pre-existing animist perceptions in a culture that, you know, has many, many rituals around cosmology or cosmological realm. And so I started to gather as much as I could people's descriptions of Angkar. Now, as I said yesterday, initially those descriptions were not forthcoming in the first interview. But as I met with people a couple of times and traveled with them, I became familiar with the way in which Angkar was being presented. We were able to just have conversations about this concept. If deceased ancestors' spirits roam, someone said to me, certainly Angkar must have the capacity to do the same. So the sense of some force that was making things happen. Some people said they didn't know what Angkar was. Some force was making things happen and creating chaos that people were trying to catch up with. How can one make logical sense of that? It seems very logical if you can't make logical sense of something and there's already a pre-existing foundational system by which people perceive roaming spirits, possessing spirits, transforming spirits, trickery spirits, spirits that could trick you. It made perfect sense that people would start to experience a particular kind of fear that was familiar to them when they couldn't figure out what was going on and the possibility of Angkor being some force.
Hay ông cá này ai miền cầm lăng ở quay mũi để dương mơ mình khơi như cầm lăng mũi để việc cao miền khăng lăng khăng lăng bị bể mũi tụ bể mũi.
Now with regard to the part of your question, Angkor's role in the wedding, I think that was very confusing for people. Because on the one hand, people would say Angkor arranged our wedding, but they knew the person who arranged it. So then there was an association with the human entity. But then after the wedding, and I gave the illustration of the couple that walked at night and were afraid even to think, all of a sudden, Angkor could be anywhere. So it's a very, very complex
Je vous remercie. Il appartiendra à la cour de déterminer si le contexte de peur dont vous avez parlé depuis le début de la matinée pourrait être intrinsèquement coercitif. Et je pense que cette discussion sera fondamentale pour savoir si les mariages dont nous avons parlé lors de ces audiences peuvent être considérés comme des crimes. Mais je voudrais vous interroger sur la conscription, puisque c'est votre thèse dans l'ouvrage, que les personnes ont été conscrites. Et je vais citer un passage de votre ouvrage, page 29, en anglais, et vous indiquez « Conscripted weddings became part of one's duty to country to propagate, literally, the communist state. Est-ce que vous pouvez un petit peu expliquer cette notion, puisque vous semblez rattacher cette conscription à la propagation de l'État communiste? Est-ce que finalement la conscription avait-elle pour but de contribuer au projet révolutionnaire de l'État communiste? Est-ce que c'était ça la finalité de ce que vous appelez la conscription au mariage ou par le mariage?
For me, it was not about propagation. It was really about the creation of structures that would lead to formal communal living sites with a cohort of people selected for that site.
Je vous remercie. Dans le passage que vient de citer, vous référez explicitement à l'État communiste, ce qui me permet d'évoquer une hypothèse que je vous soumets, puis vous me dites bien évidemment si vous êtes d'accord ou non. Si je comprends bien votre thèse sur la conscription, les résultats de votre recherche font apparaître que les personnes ont fait l'objet d'une conscription par le mariage et que cette conscription provenait de l'État que vous dénommez État communiste dans votre livre. Est-ce que je comprends bien ce que vous dites, que finalement cette conscription était une politique étatique?
I can't say for sure.
Et donc quand vous dites dans votre ouvrage, page 29, qu'il s'agissait, et encore une fois, je vais parler en anglais, one's duty to country to propagate literally the communist state, hein, donc là, vous parlez clairement de l'État,
rot comme ni.
Est-ce que vous pouvez du coup nous expliquer
ce qui
comme une contradiction entre le fait dans votre ouvrage de lier la conscription à l'État et puis aujourd'hui de nous dire qu'il n'est pas forcément possible de généraliser et de conclure qu'il existait une politique étatique. Qu'est-ce qui vous fait nuancer vos propos aujourd'hui?
My former response was in regard to the word policy.
So,
I think through mapping across time and place, weddings,
that
I was watching a policy in formation.
And that's,
you know, it's interesting. I did go back into my research last night and I withdrew my 1979 cohort from my study. I was interested to see what would happen with the percentage of people that were given prescriptions for sex, because originally it was 39% when the 79 cohort was in my larger sample, because again, I was doing a contextual study into weddings that were organized
by
agents, if you will, of the Khmer Rouge, and that was happening in 1979, so I tracked that cohort. But when I withdrew that 1979 cohort, then, not any bit significant, the 39% is 38%. Now, what is significant for me in mapping weddings is that I was clearly seeing the development, perhaps, of a policy by late 78 into 79, because things were becoming much more consistent. And there was consistency in the proceedings of the weddings, how things were happening, and the prescriptions in different regions. For example, my largest region, again, Khandal, when I took out that sample from the 79, it was the Khandal sample that had 100% of the respondents being told to have sex.
So, you know, again,
a lot of my proceedings in my research was about mapping and making sense of what happened, how it happened, where it happened, when it happened, by whom it happened.
And
de manière très... très basique en quelque sorte. Vous évoquez l'hypothèse de conscription donc d'un service national. Vous parlez dans votre ouvrage d'une façon pour l'État communiste de propager son idéologie ou son projet révolutionnaire. Est-il possible, à votre sens, de parler de conscription ou de service national sans qu'à un moment l'État, donc au plus haut niveau, puisse être impliqué dans la conception? Je ne parle pas de mise en œuvre, de conception de cette politique. Quand vous-même vous parlez de conscription, de service national, n'êtes-vous pas en train d'impliquer quelque part que les plus hautes sphères de l'État étaient nécessairement à la genèse de la conception de cette
politique?
Yes, I still contemplate this. It's still a quandary for me. Because the reason it's a quandary is because there was a lack of consistency in how people were selected for service. The fact that they were selected to marry
ពួក គាត់
ត្រូវ បាន គេ ជ្រើស រើស ឲ្យ រៀប
អាពាហ៍ពិពាហ៍
គឺ
យើង
ឃើញ
កើត ឡើង ច្បាស់
លាស់ ហើយ អាពាហ៍ពិពាហ៍
គឺ ត្រូវ តែ មាន ការ យល់ ស្រប ឈ្មោះ របស់ អ្នក ទាំង អស់ នោះ ត្រូវ បាន គេ បញ្ចូល នៅ ក្នុង
បញ្ជី
ក្រុម ខាង នារី និង បុរស នឹង ជួប ប្រជុំ គ្នា ហើយ ធ្វើ ការ ជ្រើស រើស បញ្ជី ឈ្មោះ អ្នក ណា ដែល សម នឹង រៀប ការ ជាមួយ នឹង គ្នា ហើយ បន្ទាប់ មក គឺ បញ្ជូន ទៅ ថ្នាក់ ធំ
Different things happened
among
different people in different roles.
So it could be that the district leader could have decided over the wedding.
Could be the commune leader
decided.
Could be the village leader decided. Could be the cadre told someone to have sex.
Very much incongruent.
However, there were locations where things did happen in a bit more of a homogenized way. And so what that seems to say to me, but again, this is all hypothesizing, is that there were people who were in certain regions, I would not have a clue about what their rank was,
who
were in a position, in a region, to do something
with
a very concrete plan. But the something to do was to arrange weddings
and
that will eventually lead to people not going on mobile teams anymore, people staying in a particular place. I mean, it's a possibility. It's just a possibility, having visited villages and meeting people who are still living there that were married with the same cohort and other cohorts. It's a possibility that people were selecting dynamics for a village.
ក្រុមនៅក្នុងភូមិរបស់ខ្លួនក៏ប៉ុន្តែមានភូមិខ្លះរៀបការជាមួយនឹងភូមិផ្សេងនេះវាអាចមានលទ្ធភាពដូចនេះកើតឡើង
Je vous remercie. Je vais rapidement
évoquer
les points communs, les convergences que vous avez évoquées dans votre ouvrage. En commençant par ce que vous dites à la page 176, qui est un peu similaire à ce que vous venez de dire, mais vous semblez quand même conclure, à l'issue de votre étude, qu'il y a des points communs dans tous les mariages qui ont été célébrés pendant le régime du Kampuchéa démocratique, et je vous cite donc en anglais 176. But by the end of 77, common ingredients entered weddings across regions, such as speeches, were similar in content and style regarding promises to Angkor, as were post-wedding procedures.
Yes. In terms of the speeches, they were becoming much more consistent in terms of what was content inside the speech. Loyalty was probably number one, and loving this person and staying with them for the rest of their life was probably number two. There were more weddings in early 77 and late 76 where people were asked to produce a certain amount of rice. There was less of that production content in the late 77, 78 speeches. The reason I've been so interested in the Southwest is because things that were happening with regard to sort of waves of purges or other things that were happening in the country, it would seem as if some of the, if you will, reconstituted rituals in the weddings that were happening in the Southwest were then moving to the East, because I did not, at least in my cohort, and that's all I can speak to, you know, I really did not have weddings other than some in Battambang in 1978, so then I could see with regard to when things were happening, oh, this region seems to be very much following the rituals now and the speeches now that are happening here in this area. And it seemed to me as almost as if there was a dress rehearsal that was happening. There was some way of just trying to get the system moving quickly. Everything happened so quickly, so that we could set up these communes now that we've purged the people that we don't want there, and we can move people that we do want there. And it was like a machine.
Je vous remercie. Vous indiquez dans votre ouvrage, à la page 174, que dans certaines parties du pays, il y a eu une augmentation des naissances à partir de 1977. Donc je suis à la page 174. Je ne sais pas si vous trouvez la référence. Que pouvez-vous dire à la Chambre là-dessus de cette augmentation des naissances à partir de
1977?
Et bien évidemment, je vous demanderai d'inclure dans votre réponse les éléments qui ont été discutés hier sur la politique de la démocratie, d'augmenter la population. Est-ce que vous voyez un lien entre la politique du Cambodge démocratique? Des principes moraux qui faisaient que le sexe hors mariage était prohibé, donc il fallait nécessairement se marier pour avoir des relations sexuelles, et le fait que dans certaines parties du pays en 1977, l'augmentation des naissances a été constatée. Est-ce que vos recherches, vos lectures, vos travaux vous permettent de mettre ça bout à bout?
Non.
So I traced the increase in communal structures. I tracked the function of those communes, those communal sites, where people were being married in groups and staying in those communes. I can't say in an unqualified way, but it seems to me as if purge first, get rid of all the enemies, find out who is trustworthy, create structures, and systems by which people can live in these places and then create the next generation. But for me, in terms of what I saw, the creation of the communal structures seemed to be a priority. How one moved those structures forward was it always consistent.
So
I asked question on the top of page 74, maybe at the bottom of 73, did the Khmer Rouge design structures to control sexuality and eradicate traditional gender roles and family structures? Or was it that the verbal command for sex after marriage led to communal structures that further disrupted traditional ways? If I'm staying true to my study of mapping the structure and function of the weddings and births across time and place for me into 1979,
What I found was the structure came first.
But at the beginning, the development of that structure was very chaotic,
unpredictable,
and I think by the end of 78, structures were beginning to formulate and systems of how the communal sites were going to be advanced, people living together, making a commitment to each other, and having the legitimacy, because we are talking about a puritanical regime here, having the legitimacy then to be recognized in the community as married people. This is very important. And then to move forward and have children. Now, I do have one person in my sample. I can go back on the break for the year and the place because I don't have it right here. Did say that I believe it was Ankar in this case. Ankar told us to make one child a year. One case I have, so it's very difficult for me to form a conclusion based on a sole case study.
Je vous remercie. J'indique à la
chambre que je pense avoir pour encore une quinzaine de minutes de questions, ce qui, je pense, correspond au temps qui m'était imparti ce matin. Vous parlez des mariages de masse à la fin 78, aux abords des grands projets d'irrigation. Ces mariages étaient-ils différents? Nous avons eu une experte ici dont nous avons parlé hier, qui vous a précédé, et qui a fait vraiment une distinction entre les conditions dans lesquelles ce mariage s'est déroulé et le reste des mariages pendant le Cambodge démocratique. Est-ce que c'est une conclusion que vous avez pu tirer vous-même, que ces mariages de masse à la fin du régime contenaient quand même des spécificités qui vous permettent de faire des
différences?
In terms of looking at the patterns of the larger numbers, many of them were utilitarian. We have a lot of people here on this one site, and we marry a lot of people on the site. Some people were married on the road. Again, because I delved into the 79 weddings, late 78 into 79, the size of the weddings seemed to be, can't conclude that, seemed to be decreasing in many locations. I think it was just a matter of convenience in terms of the selection of numbers. I mean, I know people have said that, weddings started at two couples, but I have some scenarios where I had one couple being married.
So
it was because it was a very, very remote region. I can think of two couples in my 79 very, very remote regions in the north, not many people around them. And then the leader decides to marry just one couple. I think a lot of it was really just convenience and got a lot of people here to get the job done.
Je vous
remercie. Avant d'évoquer
les effets de la perte des rituels et de tout ce que vous avez évoqué au début de votre déposition ce matin sur les hommes et les femmes qui ont vécu pendant le Kampuchea démocratique après le Kampuchea démocratique, parce que c'est une partie importante de votre livre. Je voudrais revenir très, très rapidement sur la question de ce terme très, très lesté qui est le terme de forcer, pour partager quand même avec vous une interrogation et vous permettre de réagir finalement. Vous avez consacré un chapitre entier de votre ouvrage à cette question que vous avez indiqué Khmer Rouge, Weddings Forced or Not. Vous avez indiqué en début d'audience que les mariages sur le Kampuchea démocratique n'étaient pas forcés, en précisant au fil de votre témoignage que vous ne faisiez pas utilisation d'un terme juridique. Donc c'est un terme que vous avez beaucoup pratiqué et pour autant vous avez indiqué à la juge Fence que c'est un terme dont vous ne pouviez pas donner de définition parce que cela ne faisait pas partie de votre étude. Ne voyez-vous pas quand même une contradiction ou un problème à conclure que les mariages n'étaient pas forcés sous le Kampuchea démocratique sans être en mesure de donner votre définition de ce qui est un mariage forcé. Et encore une fois, je ne parle pas d'une définition juridique, je parle d'une définition qui vous a permis, dans votre ouvrage, de considérer que les mariages n'étaient pas forcés. J'ai l'impression qu'hier, l'idée d'une coercition a ouvert une nouvelle porte. Vous nous avez indiqué hier que vous alliez réfléchir à cette idée de coercition, mais j'aimerais bien passer quelques minutes sur cette contradiction qui me paraît évidente. Comment peut-on dire que les mariages n'étaient pas forcés quand on ne peut même pas définir ce qu'est un mariage forcé? Est-ce que vous comprenez du coup mon interrogation et que pouvez-vous dire à la Chambre sur ce que je considère être une contradiction, une faiblesse quelque part de votre argumentation?
Admittedly, I established the authenticity of the weddings based on people's perceptions. Having done that, because I also wanted to stay true to my questions and did not want to be media-driven, I might say.
My question was answered.
You know, there's, with regard to this reflection on coercion that you just raised, which I think falls on a continuum of pressure, because it was interesting yesterday, the Sierra Leone definition was called out, I contemplated last night about the application of that within this context, given that this is the context that I studied. My reflection was really on this continuum of pressure. Coercion, if we have coercion and we have force, we have something else over here. Even within the concept of coercion, there is a continuum of pressure. Peer pressure is light coercion. Did your peer force you to drink that alcohol or not? Were you influenced by them because you were afraid you would be rejected if you didn't? These are very good questions. However, in the context of the study that I did, with the people that I spoke to, having not set out to select a sample based on someone claiming that they're a victim of sexual violence or otherwise, I don't see the contradiction between asking, is this an authentic wedding? Is this a recognized, a real wedding, and the person says yes? I don't see the logic that follows because were those people who came forward to disclose, and again, as I said yesterday, disclosures have been harrowing, but were they asked at any time about the authenticity of the wedding? They may have been, but where did one start in terms of selecting a sample? What was the criteria or criterion by which the sample was first selected? I did not have the criterion that was looking for anything first or not. I did an ethnographic immersion study into this phenomenon. The question was not appropriate, given the fact that I followed.
Si je comprends bien,
si vous avez permis de conclure que les mariages n'étaient pas forcés, encore une fois,
That was not the only factor that led me to my conclusion. There were many factors.
J'aurais très envie de vous demander les autres facteurs, mais je demanderai du coup deux minutes supplémentaires pour me permettre de... Je ne me souviens plus exactement combien de temps je dispose. D'accord. Donc ça résout mon problème.
I don't remember exactly how much is left for the volunteer team from the original allocated time.
But the additional time is one session. Très rapidement, pour que les choses soient parfaitement claires, vous indiquez que le caractère authentique, réel et autorisé des mariages n'est pas le seul critère, que vous avez pris en compte, considéré que les mariages n'étaient pas forcés sous la démocratique. Quels ont été les autres critères de manière synthétique, si vous voulez?
An overriding factor was the dynamic relational factor that people got confirmation from family members or other people that they had relationships with, that they were in a wedding that allowed them to declare that they were a couple.
And
that the response, the overwhelming response of relief. Again, keeping this in the context, that's why, you know, I know some things that have happened in Sierra Leone. It's a very different context. Keeping it in this context, the relief factor was huge. It was the representation of the meaning. Again, I said I was looking at the meaning of the wedding.
So
the meaning of the wedding for those in my cohort was relief, was a reduction in dread, was a reduction in fear, was a sense of continuity to something related to their ancestors.
And so
the factor that was huge here was that factor. I believe that's probably why yesterday I reacted to the term comfort woman, because it portrays the experience by women as being something that it was not. So it's really that dynamic, relational material from, again, an ethnographic perspective that probably overriding led me to make that conclusion, on top of the fact that no one told me that people said they were afraid they could be harmed if they did not
married,
they did not in my cohort. I believe others probably have. I mean, how could they not? Given the whole general population. But in my cohort, no. But the point about the fear factor, I had to hold that subliminal Ankar fear that was omnipresent for them while I was trying to distill the level of fear that was coming from Ankar,
omnipresent, and so on. Thank you. 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 Thank you.
Je pense utile que vous fassiez cette précision, ça donne, je pense, un éclairage beaucoup plus précis sur ce que vous entendez par cette notion de mariage forcé. Je voudrais passer trois ou quatre dernières questions sur les impacts à long terme, en commençant par ce que vous décrivez aux pages 32 et 33 de votre ouvrage. Vous parlez, je cite encore une fois en anglais, vous parlez de development setbacks, donc un impact à long terme que vous avez constaté et vous indiquez à la page 32-33, je m'excuse auprès des interprètes pour ce jonglage permanent entre l'anglais et le français. The Cambodians that I interviewed have survived physically, but many show signs of development setbacks or stuckness, quite different from clinical portraits of post-traumatic stress disorder. For instance, the ways in which women and men spoke of their fears and how they related to roaming spirits often carried a quality of anxiety found in someone who has been stalked. Pouvez-vous expliquer à la cour ce que vous avez constaté?
Oui,
retard de développement, comme vous les appelez dans votre ouvrage, ont été constatés de manière fréquente chez les personnes qui ont vécu le régime du Kampuchea démocratique.
Dans le Kampuchea,
yes. Excuse me. Yes, whether someone married or not.
This was present.
Vous parlez également dans votre ouvrage d'un retard dans le développement de l'intimité et à quel point le régime du Kampuchea démocratique a impacté sur l'intimité, la capacité de développer une intimité. Est-ce que vous pouvez donner un peu plus d'informations à la Chambre sur ce sujet?
Je ne sais pas si vous avez dit que vous avez dit que vous avez dit
Yes, from early on, there were profound gaps in people being able to live a normal, in the Cambodian context, developmental life. And also, what's left out of a lot of literature in trauma is the experience of a sensual personhood, the sensuality of oneself, and the sensual exchange between people. So during the DK period, people spoke to me graphically. It drove me to sculpt, actually. They spoke so graphically to me and cried often and would shake often, and I would then consult with the psychiatrist to make sure there was a visit the next day because I knew that they would have dreams, and the content of that material was usually around the grotesqueness of the human body. I'm not talking about the dead. I'm talking about the living. So that one's capacity, one's right, the human right, to experience one's sensual personhood. Let's move sexuality over to the side here. To experience sensual pleasure of taste and touch and sound and smell, all of those things were robbed from people.
Une question de suivi du coup sur ce que vous décrivez à la page 35 de votre ouvrage et du silence. Vous avez indiqué lors de votre premier jour de témoignage, je crois, que le fait d'être silencieux était une stratégie de survie. Et vous posez la question dans votre ouvrage à la page 35. Je vais la dire en français par plus simplicité, je pense qu'il n'y a pas de problème. Quatre années de silence ont-elles impacter les gens et leurs notions d'eux-mêmes, de temps et d'espace. Est-ce que vous pouvez expliquer un petit peu plus l'impact qu'a eu le silence qui a prévalu pendant le Kampuchea démocratique sur les personnes qui ont survécu et que vous avez pu examiner avec lesquelles vous
êtes rencontrés?
Yes, silence. Holding silence between me and another, and holding silence within myself, and holding my mind silent are three different dynamics of silence. Now, I have to bring the weddings in here and the marriages, because what I was told by couples, whether they, by people who were married under DK, whether they remained married or not, the majority of my couples remained married, not that I saw that again as a criterion, was that once people developed a relationship with the person that they were arranged to marry, for some it was the first time
For some, it was the first time they felt safe to talk about things that they normally wouldn't talk about. That was one thing. And secondly, the marriages, the significance of the marriages, I found, again, because I wasn't trying to create any balance, positive or negative, what I found, though for people, was the capacity to have, in my cohort, in my cohort, kind touch at the end of the day, or even the touch of passing somebody something and having a momentary touch. That was important to people.
Je vous remercie. Une dernière question pour finir. Vous évoquez dans votre ouvrage la peur exprimée par certains certaines des personnes objets de votre étude, la peur de voir revenir en car à tout moment. C'est quelque chose que vous expliquez à la page 35. Est-ce que vous pouvez expliquer à la cour quelle est cette peur pour les personnes qui l'ont vécu sous le régime du Cambodge démocratique, de voir revenir en carte à tout le monde.
Yes, I have this
interview on film. This was quite a profound interview. This was a couple who said that the reason that they are together is because of kuprin. That was the first time I heard that term, kuprin, that the Buddha arranged our marriage before we were born, as opposed to kuprin,
that meaning. But
I have to give the framework of the context in which this interview happened, because I think it's also significant to your former question. And that is that I was interviewing a couple that I interviewed separately. I was interviewing a couple, and we had a long interview, especially around this kuprin and kukam concept. And it was getting late, and it was getting dark. Diurnal animals, we become more afraid of the dark. This was my mistake, really, in terms of my duty of care to the person I was interviewing. The interviewing was going on so long, and they wanted to tell me so many things that I let it go into the dark. And so the person was talking about, mostly talking about his experience of his body when he was starving. I actually have a sculpture in my book of this particular person. I drew this gecko because he said he felt as if he was a lizard at times, just dragging bones against the ground. So what happened in that interview was this a whole time place collapse happened, and he started to shake. And of course, I moved the interview out of a formal interview stage to have more simple conversation, to have a cup of tea, to do those things that ground people. But at the end of that interview, before I moved it forward, that is when he made the statement. And I think that's really important. The importance of that is when he's referencing that Angkar could come out of the ground at any time, we're not even safe today. I think what's so powerful here that is oftentimes missed in the trauma literature, especially here, the intersection of for lack of a better word, intersection between the animist realm and the concrete realm in which we live. I think that from other interviews that I did, that there is a factor That is different than a vulnerability factor because the word vulnerability, it's my understanding, by talking to a linguist, the word vulnerability doesn't exist here in Khmer language. The experience of the potential for harm for a lot of people, I still think, is very great. So when things happen politically in the environment, it has a dissociating impact on people where they can revisit that and wonder, is Angkor going to come back at any time? It's profound.
Je vous
remercie, Madame l'experte, d'avoir répondu à mes questions. Merci, Monsieur le Président, de m'avoir permis de
répondre à vos interruptions. This is just a short organizational question because I want to save the chamber possibly excess of 20 minutes during the break. Obviously, part of the additional time has now been used.
Are there
any additional questions from the prosecution or the colleague lawyers?
What can we simply assign the remaining time to the defense team to the break?
Can we answer you after the break?
We may have 10 minutes.
តាមពេលវេលាដែលបានចែកឲ្យគឺអស់ហើយភិក្ខុខាងសហប្រញ្ញារួមទាំងសហមិត្តវិញនាំមុខអស់ហើយសហប្រញ្ញា២វគ្គសម្មនាការបូកជាមួយនឹង15នាទីអមិញនេះគឺមួយវគ្គបូកមួយ15នាទីដូច្នេះពេលវេលាវគ្គភិក្ខុនេះអស់ហើយដូច្នេះអង្គអ្នកមានអនុញ្ញាតទេណាបើឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ហើយឲ្យមានប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 11:15
សម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំសម្រាប់ស្អាតស្អីដល់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលសម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់ផ្ដល់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សិក្ខាកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្មនាការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 11:15 សម្រាប់ចុះ